Cindy Davis Evans of The Cindy Davis Show. I want to give a shout out to Mr. Andre Pittman of Enthrone Records. My guest today is a triple threat vocal wonder. Her career has spanned for over 50 years. She is a talented, Grammy-nominated, legendary Miss Freda Payne.
There you are. Hey, Miss Payne.
Hi.
You know what? Welcome to the show. It is such a pleasure to have you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be with, you know, on your show, Cindy.
Well, thank you. And I first met you at the NAACP Image Awards, and you were gracious enough to take a picture with me. This was about 10 years ago. You probably wouldn't remember.
Long time ago.
Yeah, long time ago. Long time ago. You were so gracious. And I just want to congratulate you on your NAACP Image Award nomination.
Thank
for
you.
Your song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love. It's an album.
Oh, it was your album. Okay.
Yeah, that's jazz vocal for an album.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, congratulations on that.
Thank you.
The single on there, Let There Be Love.
Let there be you. Let there be me. Let there be oysters under the sea.
Let there be wind, occasional rain.
Right, right. Let there, that was with Kenny Lattimore. We did a duet together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How was that? How was it working with Kenny Lattimore?
It was a pleasure.
Yeah.
He's so professional, mm-hmm. you know, and he's just a gentleman. And he's so talented, you know.
Yeah, he is.
Like, you don't have to worry about, oh, is he going to like, you know, is it going to be okay? Because I normally, this is a standard, Let There Be Love was originally recorded by Nat King Cole way back.
Mm.
But I mean, Nat King Cole's version is like sublime, I mean, perfect. And I said, how can I change this around so it make it different? Not just like we're just singing the song sort of karaoke-ish, you know?
Yeah.
And I told the arranger, Gordon Goodwin, I said, you know, you got to put a little bit of spice in this. You got to make this a little funky, more R&B-ish, because, you know, this is Kenny Lattimore, you know, and he's got the ability to really bring it, you know, and put the soul in it, you know, and a little bit of the funk. And his vocals are impeccable, by the way, because he can do anything. He can do R&B, he can do soul, he can do pop. I even heard him. I went to see him. I've seen him perform 3 times now.
Wow.
Own act. He can sing opera.
Did you know? I didn't know he had that range.
He can sing opera.
Wow.
You know? Yes. Yeah. He was back when he was growing up as a, you know, teenager or young, let's say young man, he mm-hmm. trained. Like, let's say when I was a kid, when I discovered I was a singer and I felt I was going to be professional, and I was like 13, 14 years old, and I start taking vocal classes, and they would teach you operatic arias and things like that. You know, they wouldn't teach you how to sing R&B and pop music. You know, that was something you did on your own.
Oh, okay. You have to, I guess that was the basics, I guess.
Right. When you take piano lessons, mm-hmm. they're not teaching you how to play rock and roll or R&B and blues. That's a whole nother thing. You do that on your own. That's your side. If you want to do that. They teach you the basic fundamentals of the fingering and mm-hmm. the of the finger, the piano exercises. And basically when they give you songs to play, they're usually classical type songs. They're not, you know, pop songs or R&B songs or country or western songs. No, you teach, when you study piano, you study classical. Yeah.
Wow. You know, I just want to say before while I'm thinking about it, I had your sister on here, Sherry, a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we really had a nice conversation.
Yeah, so Sherry's a real, you know, a kind of a joyous and interesting person, and she's very intelligent, and she, yeah. you know, she real, and she's very kind and sweet and talented.
Yes, she is. She is. Mm-hmm. What was it like growing up with Sherry?
Well, we were like, I guess being sisters, I'm the oldest.
Uh-huh.
We had our disagreements here and there. We had little fights, but more than anything else, our mother always taught us to like love one another and look out for uh-huh. one another. And we've done that all our adult lives. We have done that.
And go ahead.
I said, and, you know, stick together.
And stick together, yeah. Have y'all done a collaboration together, you and Sherry?
We have. There have been times when we have been booked together on the same shows. Mm-hmm. I did a Christmas album back in the 90s, and it was called Christmas with Frida and Friends, mm-hmm. and I did duets, and Sherry did a couple of duets with me on my Christmas album.
Oh, did she?
Yeah. And I have, she's a songwriter as well. And I've recorded, this is way back. I did record maybe one or two of her songs.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about your career. Wow. Your career has spanned for at least 60 years. Your song, Band of Gold.
Since you've been gone.
How does it feel to have a gold record at that time? How did it change your life?
It changed my life a lot because, first of all, the feeling was one of exhilaration, of pride. I was happy that the song really went to the top, you know, to get gold. You know, you have to uh-huh. certify gold. I was happy. You know, it was like uh-huh. There were other things going on in my life that... rendered me not totally happy, but I was happy because I had finally reached my goal, and that was to get hit records. I got more than one. I got two gold records. I got Band of Gold, and then I got a year later, Bring the Boys Home.
Oh, yes. Bring the Boys Home was a smash hit, too. I remember that one so well. That was so much unrest going on in the country at that time when that song was released, Bring the Boys Home.
It was over in Vietnam. We were at war. The Vietnamese war started in 1965, and it went on until I think the mid 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't a popular war. It was a very unpopular war, and there was a lot of protesting going on against mm-hmm. that war
mm-hmm.
that we should not have been in.
Yeah.
And, so when Bring the Boys Home came out in 1971, created a little bit of a rift with the Republican Party because there was a Republican president in at the time, and that was Richard Nixon.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't think kindly of that record. They said it was going to be banned from being played in South Vietnam because they said it was giving aid and comfort to the enemy. And we thought that was absolutely ridiculous because it was actually doing the opposite. It was giving aid and comfort, not to the enemy, but it was helping the soldiers.
Yes.
It was helping them. It was for them.
Yeah.
It would give them comfort and encouragement. And say, hey, we know you guys over there sacrificing maybe possibly your own life or a limb or an injury, and you're fighting for us, but we want you to come home because we know that, you know, it's not exactly a popular war, but we want you to come home.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That song was very popular. I still remember it, and it is just, it was a beautiful song. It really was. It was a social song, and it was encouraging for the troops.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. So let's get this cleared up while I have you here. You were never signed to Motown, right?
Right. I never
said. Okay. Yeah.
Yet people all over the world, for some reason, they think everybody's constantly saying, "Aren't you're a Motown artist? Aren't you with Motown?" I've been on shows where there was like this. It was like Motown, you know, Motown, you know, a Motown show. I was on a tour once in 2002 in the UK in England, and I was on tour. It was me. Edwin Starr was like headlining. Martha Reeves was under him, and then came me, Freda Payne. It was Edwin Starr, and it was one of those. It was sort of like billed as a Motown show.
Uh huh.
And so I said, "It's all right with me," you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this was like a 2-month tour. It wasn't a short one, a short run. This was 2. And we had a good time. It was really nice. I enjoyed it. I miss Edwin Starr. You know, miss him. Yeah.
Yeah. So who were you signed with at the time?
At that time, let's see, that was 2002. I don't think I had a label. I was on a label at that time.
Well, let's do when you were did Band of Gold and Bring the Boys Home, who were you signed on with?
I was signed to Invictus Records, mm-hmm. and Invictus Records was a label that was helmed and started by Holland Dozier and Holland.
Yeah.
So Eddie Holland was the president. Otis mm-hmm. Smith was the vice president. And of course, it was Holland Dozier and Holland who did mostly all the production work. And they were the guys that came from Motown, and they were the most, let's say, successful producers mm-hmm. from Motown. And they were, because they were in, had been, they became inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Mm. They were like on the same, they were like the Beatles, you know, because of the songwriting and the production. They produced and wrote the biggest hits of the Supremes period that they ever had.
Wow.
Talking about Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Mary Wilson.
Yeah.
Florence Ballard. And then when Florence was, you know, left out of the group, then came Cindy Birdsong. Mm. And they had the biggest hits with Holland Dozier and Holland. And then Holland Dozier and Holland also wrote the biggest hits that the Four Tops ever had.
Wow.
And also they wrote hits for Martha Reeves. And some of their, and the Marvelettes and the Vandellas. Yeah, they did a lot. They did a lot.
Wow.
So they left the label. They left Motown in 68, I believe. They mm-hmm. formed Invictus in 68, 69.
Uh-huh.
Because I started recording with them in 69, and then Band of Gold was released in 1970.
So Band of Gold, was there any parallels to your own life at that time when you did that song, Band of Gold?
No. No, that's why I almost didn't want to do it, because I said, this is for a younger girl, like a 16-year-old girl who's frigid and uptight. I said, mm-hmm. at that time I was 20. Excuse me. That time I was 28. I said, I'm a grown woman.
Yeah.
But I can't. Why should I be singing a song? But that night on our honeymoon, we stayed in separate rooms. I thought it was kind of corny. And so, when I was being taught the song, they said, "Well, forget about it. You don't have to like the song. You don't have to like the lyrics. Just sing it." And so I'm glad I did.
So yeah, right? Mm-hmm. Turned out to be one of your biggest hits. Wow. So who were your musical influences growing up?
My musical influences were Ella Fitzgerald, Gloria Lynn, Carmen McRae.
Yeah.
Let me see. What else I could say? A little bit of Billie Holiday.
Yeah.
About like that. I would say like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, awesome. Wow, man.
Now, Now, I admired Lena Horne, but more or less for her image and how she carried herself and her, and her gowns and how she, I liked her. So, yeah.
Wow. Well, what was it like working with Johnny Mathis?
Great. It was like a dream.
There are many, many crazy things that will keep me loving you.
And with your permission, may I list a few?
It was like the moment he walked into down that hallway of Capitol Studios in Hollywood, I was thinking, I almost to the point before he arrived, I was saying, oh God, let him show up. Let him show up. Anything could happen. He could say, oh, I don't, you know, like I can't make it now. Something happened or whatever, you know. And when he walked, and when he arrived at the studio, he got there on time. And when he came down and I saw him, you know, walking into the studio, I said, oh, thank you, Jesus, he's here. Yeah, it was one, it was like a dream. It was like a dream come true.
You know, you kind of grew up in an era where prejudice was really prominent back then. Is there anything that sticks out to you still to this day in regards to how you were treated?
Well, yeah. Well, when I think about, when I have to like regress and think about it, I even wrote about it in my book. I remember when this was around 1961, when my mother and I had a mentor, like my pianist, and he was a mentor to me. His name was Mac Ferguson. And we drove from Detroit to Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. And we went to Vegas because Duke Ellington had requested that we come to Vegas because he had wanted to sign me too. Man, you know, for 10-year contract that was that never executed because we couldn't come to an agreement. But anyway, on our drive, when we started to drive through certain states like Texas, Arizona, some other states too on the way to Vegas. Anyway,
Jim
Crow still existed.
Yeah.
There were certain places where you couldn't walk, let's say on the roads, you stop and you want to go into a restaurant to eat. Mm-hmm. You couldn't go into the restaurant. You had to walk. So Mac would walk in, order something, and then we'd have to take it out. We couldn't go in.
Wow.
We couldn't go in. We had to, that kind of thing. Let's see, what else? Whatever happened. Stuff like that. Oh, and when we arrived in Vegas, it was in the evening. It was like 9, I'll never forget. It was about 9 o'clock in the evening. Mm-hmm. And we finally arriving in Vegas. And I'm like in awe of driving down the, you know, Las Vegas Boulevard, the strip. We're driving down the strip and all this neon, all these hotel casinos and everything. It was nothing like it. It was like, oh my God, it's like, wow. And finally we started saying, we better find a place to stay because a motel. So there were quite a few little, you know, motels along the way on the strip in between the big hotels. So we'd stop at a motel and Mac would go in. And the sign outside would say vacancies. And he'd come back out.
Yeah.
They said there's no vacancy, but yet the sign says vacancy. Mm-hmm. You know, and they told me there's no vacancy. So we went to another one.
Yeah.
Same thing. So after about the third one, I said, what's wrong with Mac? Can't he even realize they just don't want us? They don't want us to stay here. Something's wrong. So we saw this black guy walking down the street and he must, I think, worked at one of the, like a janitor or something and stopped him and told him our dilemma. And he said, and our mother was standing there And I was standing there, and he said, "Well, ma'am, don't you know they don't allow us folks to stay on the strip at all?" I said, "What?" We looked at each other like, "What?"
Oh my God.
We didn't consider, we didn't think of being Las Vegas like the South, you know.
Exactly. Right.
And so we said, "What?" He said, "No, they don't allow Black folks to stay on the strip." So my mother said, "Well, we're here to see Duke Ellington and his big band, and they're playing at the Riviera Hotel in the lounge. And my daughter has been invited by Mr. Ellington to come as a guest artist." And he said, "Well," and my mother said, "Isn't Duke staying at the Riviera and the band?" And he said, "Oh no, man.
Oh my goodness."
He said, they're probably over on the west side in the Dust Bowl, staying at the West Motel. Mm-hmm. It's owned by Dr. Bell, mm-hmm. and so who's a Black dentist. Dr. Bell was a Black dentist. Mm-hmm. So we left. So we got on a payphone and called up, and we said, "Can we get a room there?" They said, "Oh yeah, we got vacancies." So we had two rooms.
Yeah,
we went over there, and Duke was there, and the whole band. They were all staying there.
That is just oh my goodness. Well, that was horrible, the way they treated us back then, you know.
It's demeaning. Oh, and another time I remember, this was when I was younger. I must mm-hmm. have been like about 11 years old or 12. And I was with my aunt who was my stepfather's sister-in-law and uncle. And I went to visit them in Louisiana, mm-hmm. in Jonesboro, Louisiana. And so they decided they wanted to go to Houston. They drove from Louisiana to Houston, Texas, to stay with some other relatives.
Hey, that's where I am.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
So we decided, one weekend, they decided to drive to Galveston, mm-hmm. To the ocean.
Yeah. Is that
right?
Galveston. Yeah, you're right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the ocean. Mm-hmm. And spend a day at the beach.
At the beach. Mm-hmm.
So we went to Galveston. We went to the beach.
Oh.
And now we're talking now, this would be in the 50s. And the beach was segregated. It was like you would go on a pier. I remember looking on, walking out on a pier. On the right was the white side, and on the left was the Black side. And I looked, and I mean, only Black people can go on this side of the beach. And then the other side is for whites. And I said, "This is so stupid." I said, "It's the same water. It's the same."
It's the same water. Yeah, the water. You can't segregate the water.
And I said to myself, "Who the hell do they think they are?
Wow.
What makes them think they're better or different from us?"
Yeah. You know,
I mean, here I am, 11, 12. That's what I felt. And even, of course, you know, back then. And then if you, the beach house, the beach, you know, where you change your clothes, the locker room was all segregated. Going to a shoe store, you couldn't try on the shoes.
I heard about that.
I felt, I was humiliated by that. And I said to myself, this was down, I think in Jonesboro or Winfield, you couldn't try on the shoes. It might've been in Houston. And I said to myself, how can people even continue to live down here?
Oh my God.
Because I wasn't used to that. Detroit, I was born and reared in Detroit. I wasn't used to that. Wow. And I thought it was so demeaning and so unjust. And I just kept saying, who the hell do they think they are? Who, you know, to myself, you know, like we weren't allowed to use the word hell.
No, sure wasn't. That was, you'd be cursing if you didn't use that word.
And you couldn't say S-H-I-T either.
You couldn't even say lie, L-I-E. That was a curse word. Oh,
I remember.
You couldn't say that either.
I remember when Sherry and I were really little. I think Sherry was like about 4 or 5. I was 2 years older. And I remember we weren't allowed to say "aw shucks."
Oh, really?
I swear to God, my mother said, "Don't you say that, aw shucks."
Oh, that was a curse word, huh?
It was a curse word.
Concerning.
One day Sherry said it, and my mother had gone to work. And when my mother came home, I said, "Mama, Sherry said, aw shucks." And my mother spanked Sherry. I couldn't believe.
How does it feel to be a legend, Miss Payne?
It doesn't feel any, to me, it's all I feel is that being a legend means that you are of age and that you've done so many things. You've had so many accomplishments.
Mm-hmm.
You've survived. So being a survivor is, I just feel like, gee, I wish I had the vitality and the body that I had back then. That's all.
Yeah. You know?
I mean, I'm not fat or anything or out of shape, but I wish I had, it's still not, you know, it's not, let's say if you bought a brand new car and the car is 30 years old now and you've had it repaired and you had replaced the motor and this and that and they had the tires replaced many, many, many times. That's how I feel. It's like, I'd rather have a new car.
Yeah.
I'd rather be new all over again, but I'm okay. I feel blessed that I'm still here.
Amen.
I feel blessed that I'm still here and,
yes.
And still able to do what I, you know, still performing and all that.
How do you continue to go forward and travel and still perform and all of that? How do you keep going?
Well, you have to keep tabs on your health.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you see something happens in your body, like a pain in your knees or your shoulder or whatever, and then a pain persists, you have to like make sure that you get on that, start taking supplements that aid in building your, you know, getting your body back to normality or holding back the inevitable, like when you get arthritis, eventually, you know, with arthritis, a lot of my peers have had to have hip replacements, mm-hmm. knee replacements. I myself, 2 years ago, I had my knee, my left knee replaced.
Oh.
And then last year, I had my right shoulder replaced.
Oh.
But that's from having arthritis. Now, some people don't even get arthritis. Some people, you know, don't have that problem. But a lot of us do.
Yeah. Wow.
As you get older, you develop arthritis. Mm-hmm. And what you have to do, basically, it's you have to go to alternative medicine or make sure you have a good regular doctor, primary doctor that mm-hmm. keeps you. And then a lot of us have diabetes.
Yeah.
Fortunately, I don't have diabetes. I hope I never get it, you know. Your organs, are they working well? Are they functioning properly? You have to keep tabs on your health.
Yeah. I'm dealing with menopause. That's horrible. I'll be glad when this is over.
Well, yeah, I know.
They say you get your second wind after menopause. I don't know.
Well, yeah. You won't have to deal with all that, the PM, what do you call it, PMS?
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to deal with the night sweats.
Yeah.
What else do you get to go through?
The hot flashes.
Hot flash, night sweat.
Mood changes,
depression.
I want to talk to you. What was your inspiration behind Band of Gold, your memoirs?
My inspiration was the fact that I had a life and I wanted to put it down on paper in print. And I saw... I said, look at all my peers. They're writing books. They got books out.
Yeah.
And I said, I better hurry up and write my book before I forget. My memory goes.
Wow. Can't wait to read it.
Yeah. Well, it's been getting good reviews and everybody, almost everyone that has have read this book have at least told me how much they enjoyed it. They said they couldn't put it down.
Yeah, I love biographies. I love biographies.
I love biographies too.
You
because
do?
Yeah. I love biographies because they're, you know, you're reading about a person's life. You know, you're reading something that happened.
Mm-hmm.
Not science fiction.
Yeah. And I like to read about how one thing led to another and another and another, and then the outcome of it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Progression of especially a successful person's life.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
they were always successful. They weren't always rich,
yes.
you know? So
yes.
you start out, you know,
yeah.
like along. Yeah. How did you know you could do this?
Yeah.
Wow. And you see and you find out, and it's really interesting.
People don't know that you were may have forgotten that you were in The Nutty Professor too. You played Claudine. What was it like working with Eddie Murphy?
A dream. He was so nice, very professional. And I think that he'd kind of be like the kind of person, like when they'd say finish a scene, cut, and he would like be clowning or telling jokes or whatever, you know, because he just seems that kind of like that kind of person.
Yeah.
Between takes, he would like kind of shut down and he'd be very quiet, almost like thinking about, like maybe thinking about or meditating on what he was going to do next. And so, but I appreciate, I just felt really good in doing that. I felt very, very comfortable and at home with him.
That's a blessing. I'm going to throw out a year. I did this with Sherry. I did this with, you know, a few of my other guests, and I'll throw out a year. You tell me what you remember about that year, or what you were doing. And so 1959.
Whoa. 1959, I graduated from Central High.
Wow.
1959, I was on the Ted Mack Amateur Hour in New York City, which was the biggest and the most famous talent show televised. Today, it would be like American Idol or The Voice, okay? I didn't win first place. I won second place, but that was good enough for me to have wind up getting a write-up in Jet Magazine.
Wow.
Shocked because I said, how in the world they know about me? You know, because that's if you were on TV, it's like black people on TV, black people.
Yeah, black people on TV. Yeah.
But we just like we said, colored people on TV, colored people. And 59, what else happened in 59? Oh, 1959? Or yeah, I was 16. Yeah. So those are the things I remember in 59. Yeah.
1977.
Whoa. Oh, God. 1977, that's when my mother passed away.
Oh, I'm sorry. And
it was March the 20th, 1977.
Oh.
But a few months later, September the 19th, 1977, my son, Gregory Abbott Jr., was born.
Wow.
So those are the two dynamic, most dynamic and dramatic things that happened in 1977.
1999.
Wow, 1990. Woo. Well, that's different. 1999. Let me Oh, wow, that's harder.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was living in Marina Del Rey. I leased my house out on Blue Jay Way in the Hollywood Hills. 1999. I think I signed a deal with a label, a record deal called Volt, up in Berkeley. And I recorded an album called Come See About Me that was on the Volt label and produced. Preston Glass, and yeah, let me see
what are some of the big misconceptions people may have about you?
a misconception.
Any misconceptions?
I don't know what those misconceptions might be.
Okay. So what do you want people to remember you as about or about you?
Well, that I was someone who brought some class and pleasure and healing to my audiences. Mm-hmm. That I was fair and that I was more, let's say, an honest, straight shooter kind of person.
Yeah.
Wouldn't stab anybody in the back to get ahead. Mm. And that I was a kind spirit.
Wow, that's beautiful. That is absolutely beautiful. You are such a delight and a pleasure. Oh my God, this is such an honor to meet you again. Like I said, I met you at the NAACP Image Awards about 10 years ago, but to have you here is just such a blessing. I want to thank you for being here and sharing your story and being such a delight that you are.
Oh, thank you so much.
So until next time, God bless you.
And thank you
so much.
Okay.